Have you been dreaming about me?
Have I been dreaming about you?
Paul Matthews is an ordinary man in every sense. He's got a decent job, a house, and family. It's just that even with all of this, there's something missing for him. He feels adrift. But then something strange happens. He begins appearing in people's dreams. In everyone's dreams, for that matter. Initially, it's innocuous enough, but as corporate interests and Paul's own ambitions begin to seek ways to exploit this mysterious phenomenon, things take a turn for the worse. Can anyone get a peaceful night's sleep again? Will Paul be able to satisfy his wife's David Byrne kink? Life can be a dream or a nightmare for our insect science guy. So, Reynard, what did you think of Inception starring Nicolas Cage?
You know, I have to say, I really did not care for this movie. I went in not knowing much. I was ready for some kind of, I don't know, surrealist comedy or dramedy or something, and it just really didn't deliver anything to me. And then I went on Letterboxd and was like, am I a crazy person?
Yeah, I had a very similar, because I was looking forward to this. I saw like the concept for this. I saw the trailer. I was like, that looks really interesting. You got Nicolas Cage, like, you know, in a real role. So I was like really looking forward to it, and came out of the theater like a little disappointed. It's like, that's a little odd. It's a little, I don't know how I feel about that. And then I checked, I think this has like what, like 92% Rotten Tomatoes, like insane ratings on Letterboxd, and it's like, am I stupid?
It's the children who are wrong.
I know. It's
I feel, look, I will say, like, it's from a technical standpoint or whatever, it's not like a bad movie. It's just one that for me on like a narrative level or like a characterization level just didn't deliver.
Yeah.
For any number of reasons.
Yeah, I was a little curious. So, like, before we recorded this, I actually tried to listen to Karsten Rundquist's review of it, which was more positive, to try to get like an idea like what other people are saying about it. And listening to him, I feel like I get it a little bit more. Like, I get it, but at the same time, I still feel like it doesn't quite click into place for me all the way. It's like, it's got a great idea. It does some interesting things with the premise. It doesn't feel like it's totally wasted or anything. There's a vision here, but it just feels like it gets distracted.
Yeah, I think here we have, like, with this kind of basic premise, there's, like, I'm sure there's other options you could take, but, like, here they present kind of two angles you could look at. You can either take this and be like, okay, here's this kind of high concept, you know, situation that's happening, and we're going to kind of graft this like character story through this and like use it to kind of explore Paul, right? Or you get this kind of like Black Mirror corporate sci-fi thing, and it like kind of wants to have its cake and eat it too, and we don't really get a satisfying, to me at least, delivery on either one of those. And that's kind of what soured me to it, aside from just kind of a general unevenness of tone.
Yeah, I was like, it just feels like it might have taken on a little bit more than it could chew. And like, we'll kind of walk through some of the more in-depth things here. Obviously, we're going to be talking about the full movie, so spoiler alerts for all you out there. Kind of open up. So we kind of went through the basic premise of it already. You know, Paul Matthews, beginning of the movie, it's like he's very unfulfilled in his life. He has family, but it doesn't seem like super close to them. You kind of get the idea that like he married up like one of his like his exes that he runs into, one of the first people. It's like, I've seen you in my dreams. Remarks that, oh, you changed your name. He's like, yeah. So it's like kind of like you get the idea that, you know, people kind of like look down on him, like they don't take him seriously. You know, former roommate is accusing his ideas in her work, and she's like, he can't really bring himself to, like, you know, he tries to like confront her, but it doesn't go anywhere.
Yeah, it's kind of you know, he's introduces this very kind of like, pathetic is even a strong term for that, but he's just very like, when the first like major scene is, you know, between him and his like former like colleague in grad school or whatever, and like that's kind of like when you're starting to get a sense of him as a person, and you know what she's pulling, like any form of like plagiarism is always ethically dubious, of course, but like within the like the logic of the story, when she's like being like, oh well, do you publish anything, because he's wanting credit for terminology that she's apparently using in her like draft or whatever, and like he had these ideas, and then he has just kind of sat on them and has no like ambition to do anything. And even if what she's doing is shitty, what he's doing is equally like kind of wasted in a different way, and it's just kind of becomes a pattern throughout the entire film.
Yeah, it's like one of the things I noticed is that the producer on this, not the director, but producer, is Ari Aster. And he has a trend of like basically making stories where people go from a bad situation to an even shittier situation. And that's the general kind of arc that this movie is going to take.
Yeah, I kind of got like a kissing cousin, like to like the Bo character in Bo is Afraid and Nicolas Cage's performance. Like, I think that he inhabits the physicality of Paul very well as this kind of like Muppet of failure, where he's just got this very specific way that he carries himself, and that tells you a lot about his sort of mental state and, you know, how he views his life. I thought that was interesting.
Yeah, you know, it's and I think one of the things that's very prominent is that in this early part of the movie, like as it starts coming out, like, oh, people are starting to see him in their dreams, people that he's never met are seeing him in their dreams, and it kind of starts to get to the point like, oh, something really weird is going on. He starts being like, oh, like, what am I doing in your dreams? And it's, and one of the recurring themes that he's always passive. He's not doing anything, even in dreams where, you know, people are in danger. It's like, oh, he could be doing something, but he just doesn't. And you can see that kind of like gets to him. He's like, even all these incarnations of me that exist are doing nothing, and that kind of like reflects on him.
Yeah, it's where like this sort of like, I don't know, this darker aspect to him, like he's, like you're saying, he's very passive, he doesn't like typically really do much, he just kind of exists in life, but he's also still very controlling within what he can specifically kind of control, like his daughters, he's always very kind of short with them, and even from the start, you know, and just sort of very kind of like in his little path.
Yeah, it's like, yeah, you kind of get the idea right off the bat. It's like he's kind of an asshole. He's like, because like, you know, I feel like, you know, you look at like Bo was Afraid, you know, I brought that up, like Bo was like a bit more kind of like innocent, almost like wide-eyed. It's like this guy who's this victim of circumstance, and you feel like deep down he's a good person. He's just been so horribly controlled through his life, whereas Paul is just, Paul is just, I wouldn't want to be Paul's friend.
I wouldn't hang out with, he wouldn't be invited to my dinner parties.
No.
I don't think. No. No. They're both in it, just like not identical, just kind of these figures of like schlubby male pathos in different senses.
Yeah, you know, he's just like, he kind of almost feels like, like the incarnation of like, is like, oh, like you're supposed to make something of your life, and he almost feels like he's kind of entitled to it, even though he doesn't really put that effort into it.
Yeah, he's kind of this like cautionary tale almost.
Yeah. I will say, like, kind of on the technical side of things, like, because this whole build up of like, oh, like he starts, people start seeing them in their dreams and everything, and how this all starts to kind of sink in for him. It felt a little fast for me. Like,
yeah, it was a bit abrupt, kind of getting to that theater scene, and then it just kind of jumps off a cliff where they're really delving into like, oh, this is fully a thing.
Yeah, like, it just, I feel like there could be like a few couple more beats there to make it really sink in, like, oh, like the full extent of what's going on. And it's kind of through the whole movie, it kind of feels like It feels like there's a bit of it missing, like 5-10% of it.
Yeah, and I think it's the most egregious at the very end, so we'll get to that, you know, in due time. But it does feel kind of skippy. Like, I'm perfectly fine with the rules or whatever, this being like literal dream logic. Like, we don't necessarily, I don't think for the story it's important for it to like explain why it's happening, but it needs to like do something of it and like use this as a storytelling device. And if we're kind of starting off and like, well, I guess it's just happening, then you're like, okay, well, where are we gonna head with this?
Yeah, you know, it's like you kind of want to get a better idea of establishing this is a weird thing within the story. You know, it's not just like, oh, this is a story where people randomly start appearing in other people's minds, or like, you know, there's like some kind of thing that, you know, a company can develop to connect to people's minds. That'd be a really weird thing to put at the end of this movie, wouldn't it be?
That'd be pretty weird. I don't know who would do that.
I know. And like, sometimes the editing works for the comedy. Like, you know, there's a couple instances where, yeah, you know, as they start realizing what's going on, he's told, like, you know, don't do anything drastic. Cut to him in the middle of an interview with the news station.
Right, it's just like,
you know,
just rocketing off.
Yeah, or like later in the movie, you know, it's like, you know, he's confronted at a restaurant. He like throws his food at someone. Cut to his wife pulling up to the hospital. Paul standing there all bloodied and beaten up. Like, that kind of works. Like, that works for me, but other stuff with the narrative, it's like, okay, might need a little bit more time to simmer.
Yeah, when it's like a cut to like drive in a funny point or something along those lines, that's one thing. But when you're like kind of like jumping forward in the narrative or kind of fast tracking things without really kind of giving us any internality to that, that's when things start to get a little kind of like dicey. I also noticed like early on, like there's some interesting like choices in like the sound editing. Like how, like when they have that first conversation in the restaurant where he's trying to convince her to like credit him in her publication, and then like it keeps cutting back to like him listening back to it because he like covertly recorded it, and that like that is an interesting way to kind of tell that story. And like you jump to the conclusion midway through and you're like, well, that didn't go well, and you're kind of building in that dread. But then like throughout the movie it kind of randomly does those like sound dropouts, and I just couldn't ever quite put a finger on like why. Like, was there something you're trying to tell me with that? You know, usually when you do something like that, there's a point you're making, and I just couldn't quite in the moment grasp it, I guess.
I noticed that too, and it's hard to kind of explain how I'm gonna make this point here, but it's like I noticed it, but I was like, okay, that's just like, I don't know, I didn't feel like it was serving like any like a bigger purpose. I was just kind of like, oh, you did that because that's like, I don't know, what you're supposed to do with cinema films or something. If that makes any sense.
Yeah, no, I get what you're saying. It kind of like, it's an interesting stylistic thing to do that kind of can spice up your scene or whatnot. It was just kind of like, I was starting to notice it, and it was really starting to pick at me just because it was, as the movie ran on and my like goodwill toward it was like draining away, I was just noticing more and more little things, and I'm like, you know, what am I supposed to be getting out of this kind of situation? Just like adding it on the layer after layer.
Yeah, it's like, it's, it does kind of feel like it's something that's put in just, again, because that's what fancy cinema movies are supposed to do, you know? Like, well, like an A24 movie is supposed to do, you know?
Yeah, this kind of feels like a parody of an A24 picture.
No, we can't lose A24. We can't lose them.
Keep buying your Talk to Me bongs, people.
I will say,
it's just like, I mean, like, okay, it's totally like the dream sequences are fun, especially at the beginning, or just kind of like what goofy flights of fancy can you do? Like, those are fun. It's just more like in the real world. It's like, okay, let's define these things.
Yeah. Like, I love like all those little dream sequences, and those are parts where like, again, it's just like, it's kind of fun to just see like Nick Cage walking around, just being like, oh, there's an earthquake.
Yeah.
Like, I would say one, to kind of like say something positive about one scene I actually really liked was he, you know, once Paul's like, oh, I'm becoming kind of a celebrity. He goes to this, like this marketing, like this influencer, company. And he's like, hey, that, you know, you can set me up with like, I don't know, brand extent. It's one of these like personal brand marketers.
Mm-hmm.
The most useful people in our economy today. but he goes there and he's like, he wants to find, you know, a book deal. He's like, oh, like you can connect me to someone I can write my book about intelligence. And Michael Cera is playing the other guy, and I just had a lot of fun watching him in this.
Michael Cera is very much in his wheelhouse here.
Yeah, and it's like he gets like go ahead.
Oh, I was just he's still kind of on probation after that, the grown-ups or whatever that was called. So I'm still having to take solace in the Scott Pilgrim anime or whatever. But yeah. This is fun.
Yeah, this is he nails that like perfect kind of like awkward feeling, like this out of touch modern brand guy. Because Paul's like, no, I want to do this thing to find get my book published to leverage my fame for that. And Michael Cera's like, well, have you considered doing brand deals? We can just appear in people's heads and advertise Sprite. Which, by the way,
sounds refreshing.
Did subliminally work on this because after I watched Dream Scenario, and then like about an hour later, I watched Napoleon. And when I came into Napoleon, the only thing I ordered at the counter was like a cup of Sprite because I suddenly had a craving for Sprite.
Now, like the only way I can get through the Napoleonic Wars is if I am refreshed.
The lemony lime flavor will sustain me through Austerlitz.
Conquer Austria-Hungary.
Yeah, so it's like, no, that was, I think in that scene, it's like the things that this movie was trying to do clicked together. You know, it's like, oh, It's like you have everybody else who's like reacting the certain way. That's like, oh, how can we exploit this for capitalism or in some weird way? And Paul is like obviously put off by that, as any decent person would. But he has his own selfishness, and it's kind of fun to see them missing the mark on each other.
Yeah, it's just very much like, you know, because like they're, everyone's in the room is just out of touch because like you're saying, like trying to appeal to this guy, you know, with who's clearly kind of like not, this is not his world or whatever, with the same thing over and over again. And then, you know, Paul, the other hand, is kind of showing himself to be equally out of touch in a way. It's like, is going to some kind of weird influencer thing, how is that going to get you an academic publication book? Like, you know, the market just isn't there. And he felt like the kind of like evil twin of like the Paul Giamatti character in Holdovers, where it's like that guy wants to talk to every mall Santa he can find about like Nicholas of Smyrna or whatever. And this guy is just like, I want to talk about ants in the most pedantic way possible. And it's like, no, this isn't like fun, weird, kooky academic. This is like, I know a guy that's still not going to do anything with this publication.
Yeah, it's like, I guess it's worth knowing. Like, he's like, oh, they can get me a book deal. And his wife is like, oh, so you finished writing the book? And he's like, oh.
He's like, what?
Oh. yeah, so it's just like, so, you know, again, like, it's this moments like this where, like, the movie clicked for me. One of the young women at the company, she takes him to a bar. She reveals that she has had dreams about him that are like erotic fantasies.
Mm-hmm.
And this is kind of interesting because this is the first time someone describes Paul doing something in their dreams. And I think that kind of gets to him in this moment.
He really kind of latches onto it. It's just a very deeply uncomfortable bar conversation because, like, they're both putting out just weird signals the whole time. He does have this really, like, his laugh in this movie is so specifically grating that I'm like, that is an excellent choice. And it's just, that weird, like, inhaley barky thing. You're like, ugh.
I know. It's just like he's so good. He captures, like, this very, again, this person's just, like, overall, I would just be like, I would not want to get coffee with Paul. I would not want to associate with him with any way. And so it's like, why is she having these fantasies? That's the most unrealistic part of this movie.
I don't, that's what I was like. And this is kind of, this is again, like the wheels are for me starting to come off the train or whatever. Like we have this sort of like, okay, the obvious thing to do is like, okay, this dream projection thing is kind of like some sort of like, you know, there's going to be character development coming from this. And so when I'm like, oh, well, this is the first time that he is being seen as in, there's like a transformation to his like dream persona. I'm like, okay, well, what does this mean? And then it pretty much just leads up to the beginning of the film starting to transition from being like kind of a surreal dark comedy to being like not quite what the fuck it is, like dramedy, drama, I don't know. Is like the when they go back to her apartment and he starts to basically reenact the dreams that she's having, and they're a little bit aggressive, and yet she's okay with that. Like, but like I was sitting there and I was uncomfortable, and I know that's what the movie is wanting me to do, but I was also like, has the movie earned this?
I know. Yeah, it's like it feels like, again, it's supposed to be awkward. It's supposed to be kind of like a farce, but
right.
And I was like, the same. I was like, okay, we're still in this scene. And I'm not like, oh my god, there's a sex scene in my movie. Avert your eyes, you know.
No.
Yeah, it's like, yeah, it's just like.
I'm not being prudish. I just mean like, okay, we're taking this sudden change where like all of a sudden he's cheating on his wife, basically. And this is like, he's kind of been a schlubby asshole, but like I feel like that's a little bit more of a step into a darker direction, which is pretty sudden, you know. And she's taking advantage of assaulting him by proxy, like,
yeah,
it's like, you know, it just suddenly became so much more serious.
Yeah, it's just, it's so, yeah, he, because they make a point of being like, oh, like, yeah, he's drunk, you know, like they're both drunk, so it's like, you know, he, you know, it's clear like he's not comfortable with all of this. Yeah, like that is kind of like a mess, especially with what kind of comes after this. But yeah, and just like the scene is so. I mean, the good news, Oppenheimer, you don't have the most awkward sex scene of the year anymore.
Yeah, it's just like, I guess like it's it from here forward, it kind of starts to vacillate tonally, like where this scene is much more appropriate, like a far more serious take on this whole thing. And then it kind of wants to go back to comedy, and then it kind of wants to go back to dark comedy, and then it kind of wants to be serious, and it just like vacillates wildly back and forth. And you're like, I don't quite know what I'm supposed to be getting out of this, and I'm not being like, there's no like cogent like thesis or whatever being delivered as this kind of unspools.
Yeah, and it's like this happens, Paul kind of like horrifically flubs it. He runs away. And then after this rendezvous, we see that his roommate has published her article using his ideas, stealing his words. She stole intelligence. And after this point, then the apparitions and the dreams, again, he doesn't control these apparitions by any like conscious means, but they start to become violent. People are like having nightmares about him. They can't stop having nightmares about him. Students stop climbing to his. What the fuck did I just say? Students stop coming to his class. people turn against him. His family's career and personal lives are being affected. And then the movie just kind of becomes about cancel culture instead.
Yeah, it's this very abrupt shift.
Yeah. And it's just like, and kind of like whenever this happens, I'm like, oh boy, here we go.
Yeah. It's like, oh, we have thoughts now. Okay.
Yeah. And it's because, like, I feel like on the one hand, like, a big issue here is that Paul's agency as a character.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, he doesn't have a lot of agency as a character. You know, it's like he's always been portrayed as, like, being very passive, as, like, something that is an issue that he has, but he doesn't have the willpower to overcome it. It's like it's a character flaw that is established in him. But the flip side of that with the narrative is that as these things happen, it's kind of like things are happening at him and he doesn't really respond to it. Again, you can argue that's the point of the movie, but again, the flip side is that the story doesn't feel quite as engaging.
Yeah, I think anytime the movie is going to be like the points that there's no point, like you're going like Fall Seinfeld or something, it kind of gets, it's just like, okay, well, I too was 14 at one point in my life and I don't feel the need to write a fucking movie about like my thesis that everybody sucks, you know, because he's, you know, like you're saying, he's basically made a social pariah for something that's entirely out of his control, apparently. And it, you know, people are cruel to him, like they paint his car and videotape his reaction to that, and he's asked not to go to his daughter's school play, which he wants to see. But like his reactions, like you're saying, either he has like a kind of a muted reaction to something, or he's like in alternate modes, like is just as much of a monster because he like very bullishly like just refuses to like see any kind of compromise with like the school play, for example. Like, you know, they'll say, okay, we'll record it. It's like, is it fair for him to be excluded entirely, you know, for something like this? Like, that could be argued that it's not, you know, but at the same time, this is clearly like something that, you know, at no point does he step back and say like, well, my daughter really wants to have this performance and enjoy it, so I should take the L this time or whatever. And then, you know, anytime he's in conversation with like the teacher, he's condescending to her because she doesn't have a PhD and, you know, et cetera. It's just kind of like anything that he does can only exacerbate the situation, which in a story that was giving me more to work with, that could be interesting. But I just didn't feel like I was getting enough aside from just like this very kind of like rough draft surface level approach to that.
Yeah, and I feel like, and I almost feel kind of presumptuous to be like, well, this is how I would like the movie to be. But I feel like, you know, you can have like this thing where, because, you know, this is supposed to parallel real life, kind of like online things where somebody can get super popular online. You can go viral for the most inane stuff. Like sometimes you don't even do anything. It's just a picture that was taken of you becomes a meme that floats around for sometimes a week, sometimes years. You know, like, I mean, look at, like, you know, Hide the Pain Herald. Like, that guy is now the mascot of internet historian. Like, I don't think he ever, you know, he didn't ask for that. So it kind of parallels how that it's just a random thing that can happen to anyone, even like the most boring person like Paul Matthews. But I feel like if you're going to kind of combine that with cancel culture, I feel like when somebody gets canceled for something, it's usually because a thing, well, I don't know, it's like, it's, you know, you talk about like internet culture, things like this, but he's like whenever something is, it's because somebody did a thing. It might not even be a bad thing, you know, like there's online creators who make a game, who make an animated pilot on YouTube, and it becomes popular, becomes insanely popular. Like millions upon millions of people have heard about it. Like you start to hear about it against your will. It starts to go into like content mills. You know, it's like the mere fact that it's popular means that a hatedom forms about it. And this person who just did this innocent thing is overwhelmed by that. But the key there is that they still did a thing. And Paul Matthews has done essentially nothing with his life.
Mm-hmm.
And
that's a good point.
And I feel like you can still play off with the idea like, oh, like he is, you know, a passive person. But I feel like you should have him make some kind of more prominent active choice that then triggers the dreams. Like, have him, I don't know, like, you know, instead of just being like, oh my god, this thing happened and I am reacting to it angrily. I don't know, like, have him be, like, public about it. Like, have him publicly call her out. Like, do something so that this change then feels like it's connected to his character. Because the thing that's the big issue for me is that the plot, the things that are happening to him aren't really connected to anything he does.
Yeah, like, the closest they get is kind of that retroactive, like, I forget what specifically, but he, like, publishes that kind of apology video where he's like really amped up and like doesn't go over well. Like, that's as close as he gets to involving himself in it, but like, again, that's not connected with the phenomenon. That's more connected with the like meta culture around it, if we're looking at it like from an internet perspective.
Yeah, it's like, I mean, that was just like a horrible apology video he did. He didn't even have a ukulele. Oh,
that was wild.
Like, come on, man.
Should, yeah. Commit.
The standards are higher nowadays.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I guess it just kind of comes down to, like, the movie is commenting that something exists, which is like, okay, that's one thing to do, and you've done it in a non-literal sense, but, like, I want something like a little bit more than just pointing at something and being like, yep, doesn't internet culture like suck?
Yeah. And I feel like that's the thing that kind of fizzles out, because again, I feel like you can make the case that's like, oh yeah, nothing he does, like, you know, this phenomenon changes, he doesn't have any control over it, that's the point. I feel it's like, I get that, but the consequence is that then the story doesn't feel quite as engaging. It's just like, oh, here's this asshole guy who was in a shitty position is now in an even shittier position.
Right. It can just get worse.
Yeah. Eventually, like, things really go off the rails, and like you said, he barges his way into his daughter's school recital, and he accidentally cuts off one of the teacher's fingers in the door jam.
That was wild.
I legitimately thought it was like he was gonna wake up, like, is this like another dream or something?
Yeah, like some kind of weird.
I was like, oh shit. Oh.
Ironically, there was like gnarlier door action in this movie than in Napoleon. Like, when they're trying to shut the door, I was like, someone's hand's gonna get smashed. I was so stressed, like, because I had just seen this, and I was like, oh no. But it didn't happen. Huh. We saved that for the good movies here.
He should have done that, and then it explains why, like, Napoleon, like, hides his hand in his coat, in his paintings.
His origin story.
Yeah, like, come on, like, Ridley Scott, you need to see real cinema, like Solo, yeah. A Star Wars Story. Come on.
I can watch that.
Come on, man.
Anyway.
We just keep talking about Napoleon here.
God, I mean, we'll get to that someday.
Yeah, we'll talk about it.
The Oscars cometh.
Yeah.
But yeah, like, he does, like, really sort of put his foot in it in the end.
Yeah, and it's like, and then things just kind of get weird, because, like, again, like, this tech company makes, like, a dream sharing bracelet on, and...
Well, and this is, like, that sounds like a complete non sequitur, right?
Right.
But that's literally how the film does it. Like, it cuts to, like, an image of Paul, and then just this fucking voiceover that's like, well... everyone stopped having dreams about Paul, and he kind of faded into nothing, and then transitions to this fucking dystopian, like, influencer video about dream marketing.
I feel like people who don't it just don't get it, you know?
Which is when I said, what the fuck? Like...
That was just like, okay, we're doing this now. We're just kind of changing what kind of the world is. Yeah, I was like, that felt, and I feel like the payoff for this like huge thing that gets introduced in like the last little bit of the movie is
10 minutes maybe.
It felt like another fucking hour. Like, I legitimately thought that, like, the movie's going to just end with this infomercial. I'm like, okay, that was a little weird. But, you know, that's kind of like a funny, like, tongue-in-cheek way to end this. Oh, it's still going.
It was just such a complete and utter cop-out. Yeah. Like, as I was saying, like, you know, if you're going to make this about Paul's, like, some sort of metaphor or whatever, like, the first two-thirds of the movie kind of tries to signal that it wants to do that, and like you do get like he kind of, they plant the seed of this whole like Instagram, well, not Instagram, but you know, like influencer shit, like when at the pitch meeting with Michael Cera, like, you know, the whole Sprite thing, like it's realized on a larger scale and now everyone's dreams are a fucking ad-ridden nightmare full of people with shitty haircuts. But like, it just so rapidly went in the other direction and so abandons like any sort of attempt to like, okay, like, are like, he's estranged from his wife and children now, like, are we gonna do something about that? And the answer is like, eh.
Yeah, it's just, it feels so weird because this massive thing is, and the payoff for that is that we get a gag of like showing I can add in a dream, which is like, admittedly was like, it's kind of funny. I don't know if it's funny enough to like warrant pushing this huge like plot device into the story. And then it's like he uses it to purposely go into his wife's dreams to like fulfill her fantasy of him, like saving her in a
stop suit. Making sense suit.
Yeah, you know, it's like the big old suit and everything. So it's like he, which, you know, I think it's supposed to be him like realizing it's like, oh, like this mattered to me all along and I didn't see it in front of me.
Yeah, but it was kind of creepy and really like the most passive way to suggest that anything about him has changed, because he like basically like those rings or whatever the fuck they are, like you can buy them and like train yourself to be able to do this like lucid dreaming or whatever. And it's just like it felt a little like, because she's made it, she's signaled to him that she's like, they're maybe not like, it's not done, like, but they're certainly on a break. And for him to just kind of invade her dreams is like just unsettling in a way. Like, yeah. I don't know.
I kind of got, well, maybe he's like, you know, like, because in their last like in-person conversation, like she kind of starts crying a bit. So maybe he's like, okay, I think she does like miss me and everything.
Was that real or was that like a fantasy?
I think like, because it kind of cuts between like, you know, like oh, like she hugs him and everything, and then it cuts to her like standing awake and stuff. I think hugging him and all that was just like a fantasy, but then after it cuts like to reality, I guess, I think like her crying as he's leaving is real. I think that's real.
Okay. I mean, I was like, I decided that the movie, I didn't respect it at that point. So it's like, okay, I don't fully know what's going on.
He's like, and here's the thing, again, I feel kind of presumptuous, but I feel like what I think might have worked better is like, imagine if instead of this whole, again, putting this crazy technology now into the world, it's like, okay, this exists and all that. Mm-hmm. What if, you know, he's doing this book tour because he finally gets a book deal. But it's a book about like, oh, he's a crazy dream man. He's Freddy Krueger. He doesn't like it. It's like he got his dream, but in the worst way possible. And imagine if like one night he's on his tour and everything, he like closes his eyes and he tries to like intentionally use his dream power to reach into his wife's mind and then the whole thing plays out. Like, I feel like that might have been a stronger way to hit that same beat.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. It's just like, Because again, just like this tacky giant thing, like doesn't using this as a plot device or trying to like, I don't know, like an emotional reconciliation moment. I don't know, it doesn't quite click for me.
No, it's just like, I can, like, is it, again, with like practically a lot of the things in this movie, I can like see kind of what they're going for, but just like there's this gap for me between like intent and like delivery.
Yeah, it's, and again, it's a movie that it clearly it has a vision. It had something it wanted to do. And I am glad this movie exists. I'm glad it got made. I just, it didn't click for me the way that it's done with a lot of people. And I'm...
Yeah, I mean, we're clearly the odd ones out or whatever here, but, like, I won't be silenced.
Oh, no. They're going to...
They're going to cancel me, and I'm going to have to post an apology video where I scream about how I'm sorry that you feel bad.
The lived experience of Dream Scenario fans.
I'm going to get chased by myself and shot with a crossbow.
Oh no. Save the foxes, no. Yeah, any final thoughts about Dream Scenario?
Not really.
Yeah, it's... There's been a lot of stuff coming out. Like, we're planning on
there's talking... There's a lot. I'm, like, my brain is saturated.
Yeah. Like, because, like, we're planning to talk about, like, Saltburn later in the year, I believe. Napoleon, like, that's going to get an Oscar nomination. Like, come on.
Yeah.
It's Ridley Scott talking about a historical figure. It's going to get a Best Picture nomination. We all know that. But, yeah, so, like, you know, we wanted to kind of just hit this. Next week, and now we're planning to talk about The Boy and the Heron. I'm excited about that.
Yes.
Yeah, if you want to check us out, I'm Daniel Goldhorn here on YouTube, and Reynard is Slosh Cinema on Tumblr. Thank you so much for listening, and we'll see you all next week.
Thank you much.
All right, good night.
Night.